I'm going to read here at Matthew 8, starting at verse 23. Reading verses 23 through 27. The scripture says, when he got into the boat, speaking of Jesus and his disciples, when he got into the boat, his disciples followed him. Without warning, a furious storm came up on the lake so that the waves swept over the boat. But Jesus was sleeping. The disciples went and woke him, saying, Lord, save us, we're going to drown. He replied, you of little faith, why are you so afraid? Then he got up and rebuked the winds and the waves, and it was completely calm. The men were amazed and asked, what kind of man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him. I want you to know something. There will be storms that will arise in your life. There is no doubt of that. There are physical storms that come up, and I have been, personally, in physical storms on open water, and that can be frightening. But there are storms that are of all other kinds, emotional and spiritual and relational storms that arise, and how we approach or handle those storms will cause us to either be in a place where we feel like we're in a great fog and a great storm and we can't see and there's confusion and we find ourselves more distant from God, or it'll be something where we feel that in spite of that storm, we're anchored in something that is deep and we are within sight of the lighthouse and that it is something that we can find our way through and even be thankful for and rejoice in. You understand this? Either one of those two things may take place. But as I say, there will be storms that will come, personal hurts and disappointments. Several years ago, I was with a fairly small group of Christians, and I asked them, I said, what are some of the personal hurts or disappointments in your life that caused you to doubt God's goodness or power? And they began to list off various things. I've got a short list of some of the things they said. Serious sickness, marriage difficulties, family problems. And these aren't things that they were making up generically. These are things that they were saying. This is something that had attached to their own lives. A friend's cancer, feeling alone, a parent's divorce, the death of a friend, abandoned by mom, betrayed by boyfriend, almost dying, depression, the loss of a job, robbery, in this case at the hands of friends, struggle with sin, feeling inadequate, and watching professing Christians fall away from faith. That's not a comprehensive list of all the things that could happen to someone, but in that little group, those are all things that they have faced. The storms will come into your life. How do we need to prepare for this? I guess that's what we'd like to talk about here this week. And we're going to call our message this week, why did God allow this to happen? There's something we'll be talking about next week which corresponds with this. But why did God allow this to happen? And we're here at the text that we just read in Matthew chapter 8. And Jesus models something that we need to learn, and that is absolute trust or faith, particularly faith in God the Father. The storm comes up, and Jesus is sleeping. And the disciples say, we're going to die, we're going to drown. Let's make sure we understand something. God the Father had a plan that he had mapped out for Jesus, so that Jesus says, I do the will of the Father. It was not in the Father's will for Jesus to drown or be destroyed at that moment. And so Jesus didn't panic for the rest of them. He said, you have so little faith, why were you upset by this? There is something that God the Father had, and Jesus the Son had complete trust in the Father about this. You see, his faith, his trust, is absolute. And so he was able to say, why are you so afraid? He got up and he calmed all of the storm. You know about this. A little later, still in the Gospel of Matthew, there was a time when Jesus now was approaching the cross. And again, his faith or trust in the Father was absolute. He could say, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will. Three times he prayed in this manner, may your will be done. And then with assurance that it was the Father's will, he went to the cross. As I say, the storms will come, but our preparation requires that we learn to trust the Father. And that must be taught. I think it would be taught to our children and even to our own hearts, where it will say that the Father, the Heavenly Father, can be trusted. It would be appropriate for our children, to the degree that we can teach them this, to teach them that their Father can be trusted. The Father will be with you, and the pain has good purpose. Let me see if I can explain this. I sometimes have my children endure some things that are not enjoyable and may be painful to them, but there is good purpose behind it. Some simple examples of this. Sometimes I take my children, maybe when they're small, to the car wash. Have you ever taken your children to the car wash?
Yes.
Usually, everything goes in the car from bright to dark, and then these big monsters attack the car and the whole thing, and the kids are feeling distressed about this. William, is this true?
The first time.
The first time, that's true. That's true. Which of them enjoyed it least? Well, you can tell me later. All right. All right. Now, you think of something like the car wash and all of the excitement about that, I would just turn around and take the child's hand and say, it's all right, Daddy's here, it's just going to be for good, and so forth, and I try to reassure them. I've taken my children to the doctor, and sometimes there's painful moments, shots, and other things, and I tell them, this is for a purpose that God has for us. My children are not protected from such pain, but they learn that it has a purpose and they can trust the Father. I want to tell you something. Will you listen? It is my impression as a pastor that the people who are most prone to distrusting God and turning in their hearts away from God who are difficult, these are often ones who had troubles with their own human fathers and felt I couldn't trust my own parents, and now I have reason to distrust God. If that is you, if that's the nature of your own background of human parents, one of the things that God would wish to do is to minister to that and bring healing to that so that you no longer say, okay, God is just like my human father who left me. God is just like my human father in these ways. Instead, that would want to be healed. We can say, there's ways in which my human father may have exemplified some things about God, but in so many ways that was not the case. And I want to bring forgiveness in my heart for this one and not charge God with those same kinds of sins. Do you understand where I'm going? It is appropriate to get that worked out. If you are a human father, I'm going to ask you to do this. I want you to be as wise and responsible and consistent as is appropriate, as you can be, and ask God for his help in this. Your children are learning about their relationship with God through you. And one of the things that they must learn is to be trusting the Father. They must learn this. Now, someone will say, and we're entering the second part of our message, well, I understand God has some good purpose in this painful trial. I can see his hand at work. But it doesn't feel good. But nevertheless, even though it doesn't feel good, I can see that it is good. I see something that God's doing, so I'm going to trust him. And all this seems to go along fairly well. And then something happens which defies our understanding. Something so tragic, something so senseless, we say, I can't possibly see how this could be used for any kind of good. I don't understand this, and therefore, perhaps God has at last forgotten me or abandoned me. Something gets to that point. Every real Christian will face this test. It's something that is like a wall on the path of your life. This is meant to represent the path of your life. This is meant to represent a path in your life, and you're leading up in this case to a wall that seems hard to know how to get around or over. Somebody has called this a betrayal barrier. You say, God has failed me, I feel betrayed, there's a barrier in my way, and I can't figure out my way over or under or around. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Is everyone listening? This will happen in your life in some way. And the interesting thing is, what it is in your life is going to be different from somebody else's life. Somebody else has something happen, you say, ah, that's not that big, I've seen that before, not a problem. And then something happens in your life, you say, that's it! That's the thing that I couldn't endure, that's the one thing that's too much. Do you all understand where I'm going with this thing? There will be something that will come that will test you in this way. And there is a need to be prepared for that in some respect. And the problem isn't so much the pain of it, but the confusion of it, the lack of understanding of the meaning behind it. A soldier who knows what his cause is willing to go to suffering or death for that cause if he understands it. You got this? The Christian who is martyred is ready to go to death for Christ if he understands why this is happening, or at least what the purpose or cause behind it is. The real trial is so often someone says, I'm a victim of a tragic accident. If only the car would come through the intersection a second before, a second after, but this is what happened, and I feel that now, since this injury has taken place, I'm useless to God, I don't see the purpose in it, I can't see how God would be glorified in it, it seems senseless and tragic. You got where I'm going with this? That's the difficulty, the confusion, the fog of saying, I don't understand why this has happened. As a result of such experiences in life, people have written such things as Elizabeth Elliot's book, On Asking God Why, or Dobson's book, When God Doesn't Make Sense. This is a common enough experience in the Christian life that these kinds of questions come up. What our hearts crave at such times are reasons or answers. And sometimes God gives reasons or answers, and frequently he does not. Frequently he says things like this: for my thoughts are not your thoughts. Neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. And so when we say that God gives no answers, I'm not exactly saying that. What I'm saying is he doesn't often give specific answers. So give us biblical principles where we can understand in concepts of things. But he rarely says, let me tell you all of why this happened. Not only for you, but the impact it's going to have on all these others, and what effect it will have for generations to come. He doesn't generally tell us the specifics. Is this true? So, he does give us some concepts, some general answers that can help us to understand. And we're going to mention some of those as we go forward in this case. The first principle, and this is foundational, is that we live in a world affected at every level by sin. The Bible tells us, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. The Bible tells us, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. What does this have to tell us? It tells us that the reason for so much of the sorrow and sufferings in this world is because we live in a world that has fallen because of sin. Why did Adam and Eve come into suffering and eventual death? It was because of sin. Why did their son murder another of their sons? It was because of sin. God's judgment comes because of sin. And our own sin is the cause of some of our misery. David says as much in the Psalms. He says, for I know my transgressions, my sin is always before you. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are proved right when you speak and justified when you judge. And you say, okay, that's true. Some of my sin does bring some of those consequences, but so often it isn't my sin, and I will say, that's right. The wages of sin also brings harm to the victims of sin. I told you, one of Adam's sons killed another of his sons. Cain killed righteous Abel, And Abel was not the one responsible for that coming about, but he lived in a sinful world. He died as a result of sin in this world. You understand this? We mentioned David moments ago, and he had a man killed because of sin. It was not on that other man's part but his own. You should know that because we live in a fallen world, because we live in a sinful world, there will be things that will happen that will be not because of your sin per se, but the fact that all of us live in a fallen world. I have a brother, one of my younger brothers, who has a closed head injury and many physical problems because he was hit by a drunk driver. Was this because of something that he did wrong? At least not on the surface of it, I don't think so. It was someone else's sin, Robert's. I have two nephews, twins, adopted into the family, and they are cognitively and socially debilitated because their birth mother drank heavily and they both have fetal alcohol syndrome. Was this because of their sin? There's sin of others that affects this world. Do you understand this? And not only does it affect this world, but it affects all the people in their lives from that point onward. The people in my brother's life, the people in my nephew's lives, they are affected because of the sin of others. We need to understand this very clearly. In all of this, the fault is not man's. I mean, the fault is man's, that is to say, not God's. God is not the one who is the author of such sin. God's not the one who brought about sin in this world. We take a look at the suffering and the harm that comes to people, and we understand that the wages, the suffering, and the death are being paid by every one of us, every one of Adam's children, because of the sin of man, rather than because of God saying, this is what I have designed. And not one of us is exempt from this, from suffering in this way in this world. But someone will say, and this gets us to the fourth part of our message, and it is something about the problem of evil. It brings a very familiar objection. And some of you have already thought of the objection. Some of you already have. Yes, it's true. People sin. People brought sin into this world. And as a result, we have everything from sickness to war. But isn't God good enough and powerful enough to stop that? Isn't that the question? Why didn't God stop the drunk driver from hitting my brother? Why didn't God stop this woman from drinking her twin sons into oblivion? Or why didn't God do something else to stop all of this evil right then? Why didn't God take a vicious human ruler and end that ruler's life to end that war right now? You understand what I'm talking about? There is a philosophical question sometimes posed sort of like this. If God is all good, if God is really good, and if God is all powerful, we know that evil still exists. So therefore, either God must not be all good, and he thinks some of that evil is all right, or God must not be all powerful, because if he were, he would step in and do something about it. Did you understand all of this? That question posed that way is something that all of you will hear it sometime, either in your own heart or from somebody else. That question prompted many writers to write many books, one of them, Lewis's book, The Problem of Pain. The question is, why does this happen? Why are there these painful things in life? Why doesn't God do something about it? And part of the reason, I'm going to go back to that question again, this question is somewhat flawed. It says, God is all good and God is all powerful. And those are the only two things it recognizes, and then it builds a conclusion on it. But there is something that is missing. You just listen to it. Listen. The third thing that should be recognized is God is all good, and God is all powerful, and God is completely just. We cannot forget God's justice in this equation. Let me tell you what I mean by this. People will say, why didn't God zap that drunk driver, and why doesn't he take out that human ruler, and why doesn't he rid the world of sinful people who are in so much harm? And the answer to this is that God is completely just, and God will bring judgment for all sin. Let's suppose that God said, at midnight tonight, everyone with sin, everyone who has rebellion and disobedience in their heart toward God, every one of them will be destroyed at midnight tonight. Who would be left at 12:01? Not one of us. We think, I'm a little better than that other one. He can zap them to keep me. And God says, I will bring judgment to all. And I'm going to bring my judgment in my time. And I'm going to do what God would say at the right manner. But for the meantime, rather than judging and zapping all, what the Lord says he does, and I need you to hear this, what the Lord says that he does is he will provide a way for the sin to be forgiven through Jesus Christ. He laid the burden and the suffering on himself through Jesus. He leads sinners to salvation and walks through the fire of suffering with those who hurt. And he is patient, delaying judgment so that you and others may come to repentance and be saved. The Bible says this, the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. I have sometimes talked to people and said, are you glad that the Lord didn't bring judgment 5 years ago? And they've said, I was leading a wicked life, I was deserving of all the judgment that God could bring. And in his mercy, he didn't bring judgment then, and I was saved, and I am so thankful. As we would want someone to be loved, whether it's yourself, your children, or others, to have that opportunity to come to Christ, we allow God in his mercy to spare this world until that day of judgment. And as he spares that world, there is much that happens that is evil in the world. You all understand this. So we understand that we live in a sinful world. We're sinners and victims of sin. God's mercy triumphs over judgment. And someone is going to say to me, oh, I see what this is. This is kind of fatalistic. We all just endure this until finally God says the moment comes. That's all this. We all endure this, and then that big moment comes when God says it's over, but until then, it's just miserable. And I would say that's not really quite right. Because there's something that goes deeper than this. There's a special feature of God's sovereignty. Beneath the surface, he works out things so that even what is evil can be turned to eternal good. And occasionally we see this happen. I'll give you an example of this. It happens always, but sometimes we see it more clearly. I'll give you an example of this. I think of Joseph in the Old Testament. Joseph, the Old Testament, was sold by his brothers into Egyptian slavery. Remember this? He was falsely accused and imprisoned in Egypt. All of this sounds pretty bad. Am I right? He was then raised to prominence, saved the lives of the Egyptians and of his own family, even those who had originally betrayed him, and he could say, you intended to harm me. But God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. Several years ago, I was reading a Christian women's magazine, and they had surveyed a certain number of Christian women about what their favorite Bible story was. And it was interesting to me, you know, 3% of them thought their favorite was the Book of Ruth, and 3% of them thought their favorite had to do with, you know, Mary, the birth of Jesus, and 3% of them found something else. And something like 80-some percent of them, all of them said their favorite story in the entire Bible was the life of Joseph in the Old Testament. And I thought, oh, I hadn't expected that. I thought they'd all like Esther or something. But instead, what I think was so cool about this, if I understand this correctly, is that here we have something where there's suffering and difficulty, and then we can see behind the scenes how God was working it all for good and restoring everybody together, and the brothers come to love one another again, and They're all saved because of what Joseph went through. And it's like, wow, our suffering and difficulty have a deeper purpose in God's kingdom. Do you understand this? And when we can see that, it is wonderful. Sometimes there are trials that you go through, and they may even be annoyances. Something that you go through and you say, God, why did this happen? And then a few days later you say, I see why. That was really cool. Has that ever happened in your life? I'm sure it probably has. I've sometimes shared with you my favorite, sort of superficial story about that, and I will give you the barest out, like most of you have heard this story before. I was driving to church this week.
Yes, we like this story.
You like this story? Okay. Now I'm authorized to tell it in more detail. I was driving a van that had the name of the church there in Alaska on the side of it, driving to the church building, and the road, of course, was filled with all kinds of chuck holes and other things. And at one point, we hit a bad bump, and one of the hubcaps bounced off the van. I looked in the rearview mirror, and I could see it bouncing down the road behind me, and then off into the weeds and bushes off by the side of the road. And so I threw the car into reverse and backed up a ways to where I thought it had gone off. I thought I could see it just off the side of the road, and I could not. And so I backed up a little further, thinking I'll surely find it. And I thought, oh, I've gone too far, and I drove forward again, and I didn't see it. I backed up, and I didn't see it. I did this a couple of times, and finally, I put the car in park and roamed through the weeds until I finally found the thing. And I remember distinctly thinking, I'm already pressed for time to make sure everything is ready for a Sunday morning. And I thought, this is unfortunate. Why does God allow these kinds of things to happen at just this moment? I got the hubcap and tossed it into the car and raced the rest of the way to church and put it out of my mind and went on with everything else I needed to do for that day. And partway through the church service, a man walked in who I'd never seen before. And after the service, he approached me. He said that he had come into town to get things ready for the fishing season. He had been up on a boat, which was within view of the road. And he had been thinking to himself, well, it was Sunday morning, maybe you ought to go to church. And he thought, no, I'm much too busy, I'm not going to do that. And then he saw a van go by with the name of a church. He said, that's interesting. And then it backed up and went past him again. And then it went forward in front of him again. And then it went back and went this way. And then when it finally he put down his tools and said, all right, God, he went to church. I was thrilled to hear that story because it told me that the sufferings that I go through have a purpose in God's kingdom that usually I won't know. Do you understand that? The only way I knew this is he walked up to me and said, this is what happened. Let me tell you all about it. I thought, I knew about that. I was there. But most of the time, the things that I go through and the things that you go through, you don't know how God is using this much of the time. And you don't know how he's getting this all together for something deeper for his purposes. But he promises it's true. He says that this is true. He tells us that we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. You understand this? He promises that in all things it works for good. And I will tell you one way that this is especially so. One way that this is particularly true. You see, the good that God accomplishes by our suffering, even when we see no other good, oftentimes is the refining of our faith. We come to the fifth part of our message, refined as pure gold. In 1 Peter chapter 1, I think this is the correct text. I'm going to turn there just to make sure we know exactly what we're doing, because I'm seeing some discrepancy here. This is where it says at the top of this thing, 2 Peter, you can disregard that. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 6 and 7. I'm turned there right now. 1 Peter 1, 6 and 7. And this should greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that your faith of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. The most valuable thing in this whole world, according to the Lord, is believing Him or faith in Him. Did you know that? He says that we ourselves have no righteousness. We don't have any righteousness. Jesus Christ has righteousness, and He is willing to take our belief, our faith in Him, and credit it to us as righteousness. He says, your faith is sufficient for me to give you righteousness. I will give you that because such faith and belief is that important. Does everybody get this? That's what He tells us. He then refines our faith by testing and trials. You see, our faith is kind of wimpy at first, and it would remain so if it were not tested. You know, don't you, that if you choose to be involved in some activity, any kind of activity, let's call it a sports sort of thing, let's say you join a team, they will put you through trials and testing to improve your ability. Is this true? God says you have faith, and I don't want you to be on the junior varsity team. I surely don't want you to be left on the bench. I want you to be on the varsity team with your faith, and one of the ways I'm going to do this is I'm going to give you trials and testing in your life. And the Bible says that when this happens, we are to be rejoicing in this. Did you notice that? Verse 6, in this you greatly rejoice. You're going to rejoice in this and say, this is good. God has decided that He has so much love for me that He wants me to come to a higher place in my faith in Him. Did you all get this? The things that are on our slide say, God says faith is the most valuable thing in the world. God exchanges our faith for righteousness. God refines our faith by testings and creeps and trials. All else is turned away, and what remains is a reflection of God's character. Because what God does when He puts you through these trials is it exposes what's there, and either what's there is selfishness and unbelief, and that's what comes out. Or what's there is faith in the Lord, and you cling to God more tightly, and the other things that are in your life it should not be, get purged out. And God uses these things for good for this reason. Is it worth it? The answer is yes, it is. It's a cause for rejoicing. This is a privilege. To be tested and tried in this way is a privilege. In Hebrews chapter 11, it says something about faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. And so you have two choices. I need you to hear this. Listen, church. You have two choices. You can either decide during these times of trial, forget it. I am going to fall away from God. I'm going to see my faith shrivel. I don't care anymore. Or you can say, I'm going to hold more tightly to God and see my faith grow. And both of those things happen when trials come. That is to say, people choose one path or the other. A week or two ago, my wife was traveling. She was staying with a former high school classmate and with some relatives as well, different times. But she was staying with this former high school classmate who underwent some of the most wicked betrayal and troubles that you might ever wish to hear. I know the troubles of people in this church, and I'm not sure if any of them measure up to the troubles that I can explain that have gone into this woman's life. And she has used those things in the faith of God and has a deep and wonderful relationship with Christ. I heard recently about some friends who visited someone who had been criticized by Christians that had some difficulties in her life and now doesn't care to have anything to do with the Lord or faith and has walked in the other path. You understand what I'm saying? I hear almost every week about people taking one of those two paths. You have a choice when you're under fire. To hold on to God and see your faith grow or to fall away from God and see your faith shrivel. The storms are going to come, and this is the interesting thing. These storms will come, and you will face them either with God or without God. I think some people think it's just not fair that there's these storms. I say we live in a fallen world. I say God even uses these things to test our faith, but you are going to either reject the Lord and marginalize the Lord out of your life, and then you may face them on your own. And I would not want that. If I'm going to be the disciples in the boat, I want Jesus in the boat with me. Do you understand what I just said? The alternative is to say, I will have the Lord with me close as we go through the storm, and he is the one who's able to finally turn this for good. I much prefer that to saying, I don't want the Lord with me to get this storm. We come to something, this is number six, faith that endures. God seeks to refine our faith so that we're going to believe the Lord no matter what the outcome. A moment ago we mentioned Hebrews 11. And you may even choose to look there with me. Hebrews 11, starting at verse 32. Hebrews 11:32 to the end of the chapter lists off the things that were happening that refined the faith, that showed the faith of many of the Old Testament believers. Hebrews 11:32, and what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and the prophets, who through faith, and this is things they did, conquered kingdoms, administered justice, gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. Others were tortured and refused to be released so that they might gain a better resurrection. Some faced jeers and flogging, while still others were chained and put in prison. They were stoned, they were sawed in two, they were put to death by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains and in caves and in holes in the ground. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised. God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. I want you to notice something. In the first, say, three verses, starting in verse 32 up to about verse 35, it lists things that were accomplished through faith. And this list is pretty extraordinary. It says that they conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, and shut the mouths of lions, and quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword. And their weakness was turned to strength, and they were powerful in battle, and they routed enemies, and women received back their dead and their life. And you would say, that's the kind of faith I really enjoy. That's really good, right? And then right at that moment, in the middle of verse 35, the list sort of changes. Maybe you noticed. And there's another group of folks who are empowered to go through trials without deliverance and without any seeming miracle. And they were tortured and refused to be released. And they faced jeers and flogging. They were chained and put in prison and stoned and sawed and threw and put to death by the sword. They were poorly clothed and destitute, persecuted, mistreated, homeless, sheltered in caves and holes. I want you to understand. Are you catching this? God says, I want you to have this enduring faith in me that I am doing something through all of this, no matter how it turns out on a temporal level in this physical world, whether you are saved by a miracle or whether you go down to death, it does not matter. I want your faith because your faith endures forever. Do you get this? And all of the ones in this list and all of the ones in this list, it says at the end of the whole thing, were commended for their faith. Everyone. If we endure, if we embrace suffering as God's tool to refine our faith, he then says we're being prepared for a better kingdom. A kingdom of heaven is prepared for us. All of them committed for their faith. And that brings us to the last part of our message. I've said earlier, the storms will come. The storms will come. Young people, children. Children who are old enough to understand what I'm talking about. There will be hard things that come in this storm. You can go through them either on your own, in a way that I don't recommend, or you can go through them with Jesus Christ. I do it yourself. He says those storms will come. We can learn something from our friend Job in the Bible, who lost everything and didn't get any real explanation from God, at least no specifics. We can see as the reader some of why this happened. Job was not given specifics. His friends and his family encouraged him to curse God and die. But Job held on to his faith, and he went a step further than that. He praised God. Did you notice that? He says, "The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." He thought, I'm going to not just fail to curse God, I'm going to give praises to God and bless the Lord in spite of it. Did you get this? That's biblical. The Bible gives us reason to say that in all of these difficulties, we are to be rejoicing. Let's see, we're going to go to this. Philippians chapter 4, rejoice in the Lord always. I say it again, rejoice, let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God. Here it says, you may think there's reasons to be filled with anxiety and fear because of the troubles of this life. It says, no. Take those things and cause that for you to rejoice in the Lord. And it says, the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. The Apostle Paul says, I know what it is to be in need. I know what it is to have plenty. I've learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, living in plenty or want. I can do everything He gives me strength. There's a place for giving credit to the Lord and rejoicing in the Lord, no matter what it is that happens. Without knowing what I was going to be preaching about, that is to say, our friends, Mr. and Mrs. Warner, didn't know what I'd be preaching about. They're not here. They live elsewhere, and they didn't know what I would be preaching about this week, but they sent to me a testimony from roughly 10 years ago about a time when they lost a baby. And said, we wanted to send this along to you, and if there's any in the church that you think might be blessed by this, we just thought we'd send this week. It's interesting how God moves things to come together at just the right time and the right way. And this thing, it's really a small book, and I'll read you a few paragraphs. Is that okay? Your little daughter, Brooke, says the following, thank you, Brooke, you taught us how to love. We loved you so deeply, came naturally because we were your parents. But all of the events surrounding your life and death brought us to a new place in our lives. You left me, said Mrs. Warner, with empty arms and an empty womb, but with a full heart, a heart full of love. You also left me with the question, will I go on to love God and others no matter what? Will I go on to fulfill the purpose of my life? Will I join you in proclaiming with each moment's breath, my soul magnifies the Lord? She says through that question, she surrendered once again to the Lord, saying, I guess that's the best way. It's better not to see what lies ahead. God didn't tell her what would come next, and she didn't know this was coming. It's better not to see what lies ahead, lest we choose a different road and end up missing out on the blessings of God and living far from the presence of God, separated from God, void of purpose. There was purpose that God had in this event. And she thought, well, it was best that God didn't tell me ahead of time, but I could cling to Him through it all, and I know that He is good, and I'm not going to turn away from loving God and loving others. I'm going to hang on to God. And then she goes on. This brings me to the final and most enlightening lesson of all. At least for her, she felt like this next thing she's going to say was what she learned the best. The few weeks following Brooke's death, I experienced suffering that I had never before experienced. A desperate emptiness, deep sorrow, hopeless longing, and real physical and emotional pain seemed to haunt me, robbing me of sleep and peace, and sometimes sanity. I tasted the unexplainable sorrow that a person feels when a loved one dies. Sorrow and pain can carry with it a great cloud of confusion, causing a person to be literally unable to control thoughts. I can barely arrange my thoughts, let alone direct and arrange prayer to God. In the previous months, I had always received such quick, clear comfort and guidance, but now that I've experienced real physical longing and pain, I am on my own. Where is God? Where is my comfort? There were times of breathless panic when I felt as if I could not go on, unless I could go and get my baby and hold her and touch her and care for her. My heart and arms and womb acted, or ached that is, with emptiness, as I held the blanket in which we had wrapped her body. I was not comforted by the fact that her spirit was alive. I wanted her actual physical body back with me. The spiritual stuff is great for a spiritual need, but this is real, this is physical, and God is not satisfying my need. One night I cried myself to sleep, feeling so alone, and surrendered to the hopelessness that God had no interest or place in a time of real need. What she's doing is she's saying, yeah, there's spiritual and emotional things that happen, but that's not real. There's physical things, and that's what's really real, and God isn't helping me with what's real. So she's going to pray. I woke up next morning with another painful panic. I sat up and put my feet on the floor and was getting ready to go get the baby. I desperately needed a nurser. That's what she thought that next morning, where the baby was no more. And there was no baby. As I lay back down, I felt the strangest kind of feeling, as if someone were there waiting for me to say something. It was God himself waiting again, inclining his ear. Have you ever had this feeling? Have you ever responded the way I did? I was short and impatient as a child who was not getting her way. I said, my body needs my baby. I need her, and you're not helping me. This is too hard. I'm longing for my baby. At this point, I was literally interrupted with a contrasting thought that gently made its way right into my line of thought. And that thought was, my soul follows hard after thee. After the Psalms. Where did that come from? She was thinking all these other thoughts, and this was not one of the thoughts she was thinking. And the thought that pressed itself on her was, my soul follows hard after thee. I wasn't even thinking about that, but I continued with this thought. My body longs powerfully for my baby, but my soul follows hard after thee. Early in the morning will I rise up and seek thee, and because thou hast been my help, under the shadow of thy wings I will rejoice. God was there once again with my comfort. No, he was not going to provide the actual physical needs in the way that I felt that they should be provided, but the spiritual need, my soul's need, he never satisfies. I was faced with a great decision, a decision I believe we all face each moment of each day. We have before us two different worlds, and we have before us the choice. Which one will we embrace? And she delineates a physical world, as we can see, and a spiritual world which lies beyond that. And I don't think she's trying to say that the two of them have no connection, but what she does say is that God sometimes uses the events of the physical realm around us to get our attention, and it causes to spiritually follow hard after him. Do you all get this? And she was faced with a choice, will I follow after the Lord or not? And her decision then and now is she would follow him. And to even praise God for the privilege of suffering through this. And I will say to you, God has a purpose in what he does in your life right now, and in everyone's life, either they're coming out of some difficulty, or they are in a place where things are relatively calm, but they will soon be coming into a difficulty, or they're in the midst of some great difficulty right now. We live in that kind of world. And I will tell you this. How you properly think this through and prepare yourself will either put you on that storm of confusion where you can't think straight and it does not become a blessing, or will put you in a place where you have an anchor that you can hold to and you say, even this is something God is using for great good. Our message so far has been one that said, why did God allow this to happen? And next week we will ask a question that is similar, but maybe turn the other direction. Why didn't I get what I wanted? We'll ask something about that next week. Why didn't I get what I wanted? I'm going to have the worship leaders come back.